4-year lamb. Cody's dad said, "Dad, this is a 4-year lamb. Dad, I'm going to get married." And his dad said, "Oh, you are, but do you have a girl yet?" He said, "Yes, sir, you do. Who are you going to marry? I'm going to marry Grandma." "Oh, you are? Well, why would you marry Grandma?" "Because she loves me, and I love her. And she's the best cook and the best storyteller in the world." And his dad said, "Well, son, that's good. But we got to talk. What problem?" "Well, how can you marry my mother?" 4-year-old said, "Why not? You married my mother." Get your Bibles and turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Do you ever come to the place that you just don't want to hear the news? I can't tell you how many people have told me,
started
at this church that's saying he's a charlatan, he's a trickster, he's a fraud, he's not the real deal. You can't believe him, and they say this. And then there's some others who are confused about the second coming, the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there's some who didn't think it was necessary to work anymore. If the Lord's done about something else now, I'm just going to drop them, just wait. And there's some of them, there's some that we get left in the morality. And there's some that was a crisis when it came to leadership. And then there were others that were going through persecution. And so all kinds of problems in Thessalonica, and Paul is addressing this. But you know, if you look at it, you've got problems this way. And there's issues, and these issues, and some of the teaching that he gives these folks, really, we can use it. And the first one, and you got outlined back to the first one, is this one. Christians should not be deceived. Christians should not be deceived. Now, I'm directing this message to Christians, and I'm trusting that you're a Christian. And that just means you're born again. That means that you are saved. That means that you know without doubt. If you die today, you've been deceived. Well, that's one thing. To the time, if you're not saved, you don't lose a single save today as the great news. But Christians should not be deceived. We've got a lot of deception going on in our world today. We got a lot going on in our country today. We've got a lot going on in the churches today. And I think so, because the Lord told us in Ephesians, we must not be false in God. Against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness, against spiritual wickedness in high places. There is the multitude right here. You don't have to go into the church because Satan wants to stop any real church that's trying to preach the word of God, that's trying to pray, that's trying to lead people to Christ. Satan doesn't like that at all. And he tries to get involved. And so he was doing that here with Thessalonica. Somebody had forged the letter. They'd signed Paul's name. And they had said, in effect, the rapture's already taken place. You're in the day of the Lord. And the day of the Lord is final for you. They're in the Old Testament and the New Testament. It always refers to the last days, the end times, the day of the Lord. This particular day of the Lord is speaking of the tribulation. The 7-year period is going to be literally, you could say, hell on earth. It's going to be a horrible time. And so these saints, rightfully so, thinking that, they were believing that, they missed the rapture of Jesus, or they didn't make it. And they were walking around, or maybe thought some of the Christians, some of your family, or Christians, or family, and that was around. And it caused them to have to make it happen. You know, don't be deceived. Let no man deceive you. There's a lot of quacks out there. There's a lot of false teachers and false religions and policy. You rest with us. You don't be troubled. Don't be shaken. Don't be deceived. And then he goes on and teaches some other things in verse 4. Let's go back and read them for you again. Let no man deceive you. Any man. For that teach that I come except that I'm falling away first. The man of sin be revealed in Son of Perdition, who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? Who is he talking about? He's talking about the Antichrist. He's talking about the beast, the man of sin. He's talking about the wicked one, the son of perdition. Son of perdition means that judgment is coming upon him. And Paul says that in order for us to have the day of the Lord, there's going to be a falling away first. There's going to be an apostasy. And then the Antichrist has got to come first. It's before the tribulation's over. as God, seeing through the temple of God, showing itself that he's God. That has always been Satan's desire to be worshipped. And so now he's going to have his Superman, if you will, to be worshipped. And he will empower him. And he's going to demand this other Christ against Christ. Instead of Christ, he's going to demand the worship of man. And so, what you do remember, I don't know if you can write this down, Isaiah 14. If you want to read this, Isaiah 14, you see him saying, I will be like the Most High. He said, I will ascend to heaven. I will exalt heaven. I will sit in the mount of the congregation on the sides of the moon. In other words, Satan, through the Antichrist, will sit in the throne and sit in the temple and threaten the Antichrist. Now, the temple, for the Antichrist to see, the temple's got to be built. And it will be built during the tribulation. And the front seats are gathered now. There's five of them. One of them will be used. It's there. They're there. They're training the people to do the sacrifices. The young people to be the priests that will do the sacrifices. They're training. They've been training. Everything's in place. You say, yeah, but that could take years and years for the temple to be built. They believe that they need to be rebuilt in 2 or 3 months. And so that's going to come on the scene very quickly as well. And it says in verse 3, you see at the end of it, it says, that man of sin be revealed, son of perdition. So if the rapture is near, and every teacher and commentator that I know, that I read from, that I study from, is in agreement, we're very close to be any time. Things that I've talked to many Christians, to many of you, we just believe we agree. So we're probably very close. It could happen today. It could happen tomorrow, next week, next month. But we're very close to the rapture. The rapture of the church. But notice it says, it says waiting, or at least it is implied that he's waiting to be disclosed. He mentioned thankfully, read further. There's many antichrists. Okay? Don't be confused. Many are against Christ. And there's already a spirit of antichrist. Listen, there's a spirit of the antichrist. So, there's all kinds of things that will happen during the tribulation that you begin to see even here. It's just amazing. And if you do look at the news, you see these things unfolding. They'll have to come about. The Bible tells us that in verse 5, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. And now you know that what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now liveth will not until he be taken out of the world. Now you see, to let that let there, let you know, let it will let. Let is an old fashioned word that means restrain. So he who is restrained will restrain is restraining. Who is it that restrains? In other words, who's holding back the Antichrist from coming in? It's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is he who lets, he who restrains. So the Holy Spirit has two major jobs. He ministers to the saints, but he also hinders Satan. The Holy Spirit does. Don't think that the Holy Spirit's inferior in any way to God the Father or God the Son. The Holy Spirit is God, the third person of the Trinity. And he's holding Satan back. And as I mentioned a while ago, Satan would not even want that to destroy this church. And many other churches that are preaching the truth, he would not like that. It's not part of a lot of churches. They're preaching error, they're preaching prosperity, or they're preaching some false, I won't say false gospel because it's not church, living church, church that's standing by souls. Yeah, he doesn't like that at all. And so he mentions something else here in verse 7. He says, the mystery of iniquity. The mystery of iniquity. What is that? That's the wickedness that's already working and certainly could be working. It is an organized, invincible, terrorless, demonic activity or spirit. The Bible calls it the mystery of iniquity, the mystery of wickedness. And you realize how horrible the Antichrist is going to be, and you realize how horrible the tribulation is going to be, you better be thankful for the restrainer, the Holy Spirit. You better be thankful that he's holding Satan back. Who is his Antichrist? We do not know who the Antichrist is. Chances are, if the rapture will happen soon, chances are, he's already alive. He's already probably gone. He's already active. We just don't know who it is. But I'll tell you what, when he comes on the scene, the church will be gone. The church will be raptured out of here. We'll come back to that. But when the Antichrist comes on the scene, he will be an intellectual genius. I mean, he's going to blow everybody away. He's going to have the answers. It kind of reminds me of the way Solomon was. People would come from all over. We talked about the Queen Sheba. People would come from all over to hear Solomon. His wisdom was incredible. And people are going to come and they're going to fight with this Antichrist because he's amazing. He just has the answers. He's going to be a fool with that wisdom. And Satan is going to be pushing the buttons. And we have to be willing to pay for him. And they will. Women will swoon over this guy. Teenagers, young adults, they will praise him. They're following him. And then he's going to require the beast to take him with his teeth. They don't want him at all. They take the mark of the beast. They want to do that. But here's what happens. If you happen to not take the beast, they'll take him for the beast. You can't do anything. You can't go to the grocery store. We just stop at the grocery store at the drop of a hat and pick something up. We just go to restaurants at any time and we get something. You can't do that. You will not be able to do that anymore. You will not be able to buy a house. You will not be able to buy furnishings or furniture or rent. You will not be able to buy a car. You say, well, what if you already have a car? Well, you can get back gas. You'll never do anything. And you'll lose your job. You will not be able to have your job. You know, think about it. You see a tiny, but you set up the cursor just a little bit. When you say, oh, if you don't have the vaccine, you're not going to be able to do this. In fact, you're not going to keep your job. And there's people that lost their job. If you don't get the vaccine, you're losing time. And there's people that do. You're going to fly. You're not going to be able to do this. You're not going to go in here. You're not going to do that. If you don't get the vaccine, that was nothing. Compared to the way it's going to be. If you don't have the mark on your forehead or your hand, you're not going to be able to do anything to function. You won't be able to have insurance. It's just anything you need. You're going to be able to buy yourself. It says in verse 11, this calls natural sin and strong delusion. That they'll believe a lie. That they'll not be damned who believe life that's in bad pleasure and unrighteousness. So everybody who takes the mark of the beast is damned to the devil's hell. You say, well, preacher, I don't like that kind of preaching. I don't either. That's what the Bible teaches. That's exactly what's going to happen. Folks, when you come across somebody that's lost, because if they don't come to Christ, they will perish. The Lord Jesus will help believe in a God that would send you to
so they don't have to go to hell. But if they're going to deny his son, if they're going to refuse his son, and they're going to walk on that cross and his blood that was shed for them, that's what's going to happen. And people are going to believe a lie. And I say this, one of the things that we studied last year, we studied Revelation last year, it's about this last year. And one of the things that I keep seeing, the more I study, that's the theology. The more that I see, you see the precursors already. Just about everything is already. See, this deception. See, we're just for me, it's not for this time. The deception. He says here that he would send strong delusion. Delusion. In other words, that they believe a lie. Did you? That's the only way he explained what's going on right now. People already believe a lie. You can show them this is what's happening and this is what's happening. Not at all. It's so clear. Do they believe a lie? And you share the gospel, you have to perish. I don't believe that. They believe a lie. I was talking to my dad just yesterday. But he says, you're wonderful. And that's the fact. And he gets her up. Because she had to find out she is a Messiah. And she just came out of her religion. And I said, it's a religion. It's a false religion. She believes a lie. She will not. She hears the truth, but she don't believe it. She chooses to live a lie. So, one of the biggest things here, and I spent more time with this than second thought, Christians should not be deceived. Number two, Christians should not be disturbed. Christians should not be disturbed. Look at chapter 1, verse 7. 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 7. And to you who are troubled, rest with us. When the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels, peace with us. Let me give you two reasons you're not disturbed. Let me not be disturbed because of who's coming. Don't be disturbed because of who's coming. He's coming. It says right there, Jesus shall be revealed. Can you think about what's the hope? It's in heaven. One of the things I want you to hope to be, I don't know if anyone wants to be, not to be, so you have a lot of conservatives and Christians, Christians. And one of the questions he asks is there any hope? Do you see any hope? He'll ask something to answer. Is there any hope? What is the hope? What is the hope? What is our hope? Let me tell you something. It's not in politics. It's not in the president. You can change presidents every other month or every year. It's not in the president, folks. You better hear me. It's not in the president. It's not in the education system. As much as it needs fixing, it's not in the education system. It's not in science. It's not in technology. What is our hope? It's in the one who's coming. Jesus Christ. He's coming. There's people that think if we could just get the stock market, if we could just get economy strong, if we get... No, the hope is not there. It's in Jesus Christ. You say, well, yeah, but everything's getting dark. Yeah, but look at verse 7. The Lord Jesus shall be revealed with his mighty angels. Don't be disturbed because of who's coming. And then, it's not like the whole script. Because of when he's coming. When he's coming. Look at verse 7 again. You see the word when? When the Lord Jesus shall be revealed. It's if he shall be revealed. It says when he shall be revealed. When is he coming? On time. Perfect time. We're in Central Standard Time. He's in perfect time. And that's when he's coming. You can't rush it. You can't slow it down. You can't stop it. He's coming. The King is coming. And if you're saved, don't be blown away. So just listen to people. He says it's just for you. And me. Let's not get blown away with what happens. I am not surprised. You can tell me just about anything. What did you hear? No way. And you could
family are disappointed. Your loved ones are disappointed. Work is so disappointed. I got disappointed one time when I was getting a tooth removed. I was getting it was the first time I ever been put to sleep. I was getting a wisdom tooth. Finally, I was a little bit of wisdom and they took it out. I was getting a wisdom tooth removed. And they gave me some laughing gas. I was laughing. I was relaxing. And then they put me on the floor. I remember the phone call. I was calling. I said, I'm going to be putting it down. I just thought, I'm not these people. What am I doing? Who are these people? Now I'm going to go to a person that they're going to last for. Well, I'm second day. They're saying, Mr. Skinner, Mr. Skinner, you can do that, Mr. Skinner. He's like, disappointed. I was disappointed. I said, can I please just stay here a little longer? I feel like that. Can I stay? You know, I want to stay long. I just had the best dream I've ever had in my entire life. Folks, I went to heaven. It was awesome. I mean, it was wonderful. And there was Mr. Skinner, Mr. Skinner. It was so good. I said, I'll stay here for a while. I said, just a little longer. And I said, I get back down and I like it. So I was disappointed. But let me tell you, in the spiritual realm, Christians, we all have to be disappointed. You know why? Because God is in control. Sovereign God. No matter what it looks like, God's in control. He's sovereign. He's totally in control. Satan and his minions are just doing what God will allow them to do. And then he's going to write the news. He's going to take care of it. And one more time, the Bible says 2 Thessalonians 2. I like to say 2 Thessalonians 2 one more time. He says, and then shall thou wicked be revealed, wicked be revealed, and the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his life, as it destroys the brightness of his coming. With them that come on together, the wicked will not be able to hear how he makes the wicked mind. Also, he's those who are following him. And the Lord's going to take care of them. With the strongest, powerful aircraft and tanks and artillery that this world's ever known. With his word and the brightness of his coming, he will destroy them. He'll take care of all of that. Just remember this. When people are doing wickedly, just remember they're going to get theirs. In fact, let's look at one more scripture. Go back to chapter 1, 1 more time, 2 Thessalonians 1 and verse 8. It says, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them. Look what it says. That know not God, and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. The Lord Jesus is coming. He's going to take care of Satan and the Antichrist and the false prophet and all of the followers of him. So you don't have to. That's why you don't need to try to seek vengeance or revenge on anybody. That's not your job. But you know what they do now. It's okay. The Lord does. And the Lord will take care of them. And all those who are mocking God and taking his name in vain and refusing him and laughing at Christians and so forth and so on, they'll get back. But not for us. He'll take vengeance. But there's two aspects to the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. First, he's coming for his bride. That's the rapture. Our pops are caught up, steps away, and he's second, in a split second, less than a second, way less. We'll be with the Lord. We talk about this, but in a split nanosecond, we'll be with the Lord. We'll be with the Lord. You know, the Bible says, we'll forever be with him. So if you're saved and the rapture takes place today, you'll be with him forever. He'll never depart from you. You'll never leave him. You'll always be with the Lord. The Bible says, the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. 7 years later, after the rapture, we meet him in the clouds. The world doesn't see him coming. We meet him in the clouds. 7 years later, we come back with him. We keep him back with his bride. He's coming for his bride, and then he's coming back with his bride. And at that point, he said, every knee shall bow. Every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Let me close with this. There are some folks there on vacation to keep them so really old church. It was beautiful. And they saw the manuscript, and they said, is there a way we could just go ahead and look at this church? It's so pretty. They said, sure, you can. The key is in the lock. Just go on in. And so they go up and they try to turn the key, and it wouldn't. And so they said, let me try. And they shook it and tried it. And they wouldn't. Somebody took the key out, and they wiped it off with a handkerchief and put it back in. It still wouldn't turn. But at that time, the man is back in John. So I'm so sorry. The reason that you can't unlock it is because it's already unlocked. You just need to lift the latch and go on in. I want to tell you, if you're here today and you've never been saved, the door is already unlocked. Jesus paid it all. You don't have to do it. Quit trying to work. Quit trying to be good. Quit trying to do something to get to heaven. He's already done it all. He paid your sin debt. You just need to trust him, believe him, and repent and turn to him. And you can go ahead. In fact, he said, I am the door. I am the door. He's very clear. There's no other way. Let's all stand with our heads bowed, our eyes closed. If there's anybody here, you don't know, come on, you don't know for sure.